Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala ashrafil anbiya wal mursaleen. Nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in, amma ba'd. Allahumma muallima Ibrahim allimna, wa mufahima Sulaymana fahimna. Allahumma allimna ma yunfa'una, wa anfa'na bima allamtana, wa zidna ilma. Innaka anta al-alim al-hakim. So Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, today we'll start the commentary and explanation of a book called Qawa'id al-Arba, the Four Principles. A book authored by Shaykhul-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul-Wahhab, who died in the year 1206 after the Hijrah. And bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, in the next hour or so, we'll continue after Salah, we will finish the whole book with a short commentary. So the Mu'allif rahimahullah ta'ala, Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he said, أسأل الله الكريم رب العرش العظيم أن يتولاك في الدنيا والآخرة وأن يجعلك مباركا أينما كنت وأن يجعلك ممن إذا أعطي شكر وإذا ابتلي صبر وإذا أذنب استغفر فإن هؤلاء الثلاث من عنوان السعادة. صوت واضح؟ Can you hear that? Can you hear everything? طيب. The Mu'allif, he says, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. He starts off with the basmala. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful. And this is the way of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in his letters and his writings to the muluk, to the kings and the rulers in his time from the other lands and the other countries. If he would write a letter to them, he would start with, what would he start with? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Good. طيب. Then the Mu'allif rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, أسأل الله الكريم. I ask Allah the most generous, the Lord of the throne, to protect you in the world and the hereafter. He makes a dua and a supplication for the student and the reader of this book. And then he says, وَأَنْ يَجْعَلَكَ مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتَ. And to bless you wherever you are. Someone that is fruitful, someone that is blessed wherever he is. And then the Mu'allif rahimahullah, he says, he makes three supplications. And these three supplications, he mentions at the end, that they are the blueprint and the signs and the recipe for happiness. The first is, إِذَا بَتُولِيَ. First is, إِذَا أُعْطِيَ شَكَر. That if he is given something, if he's given a blessing, he is grateful. It's number one. If he is given, he is grateful. وَإِذَا بْتُولِيَ صَبَر. And if he's tested with a calamity, then he is patient. وَإِذَا أَذْنَبَ اسْتَغْفَر. And thirdly, if he commits a sin and he falls into sin, then he seeks forgiveness from Allah Azza wa Jalla. And these three things is what a life of a Muslim revolves around and is based upon. Either he's given a blessing from Allah Azza wa Jal, so he gives thanks for it and he's grateful to it, to Allah Azza wa Jal for this blessing. And we mentioned last time, if some of the brothers are here, that being grateful to the blessings of Allah Azza wa Jal, they are done so by three things, by three ways. You guys remember? Being grateful to Allah Azza wa Jal, if He gives you a blessing.
When calamity strikes, be patient.
No, now we're talking about blessing. If Allah Azza wa Jal gives you a blessing, you are grateful. How do you show gratefulness to Allah Azza wa Jal? Gratitude. Okay. Zakal khair is good. I'll mention that. But there's something more bigger than that. MashaAllah. Okay, good. We're getting there. Tayyib, you guys remember? Tayyib, being grateful to Allah Azza wa Jal with the blessings that He gives you is by three ways. It's through your heart, limbs, and your tongue. Remember now? Your heart, your limbs, and your tongue. Your heart, you be grateful with your heart by acknowledging that this blessing is from Allah Azza wa Jal. by acknowledging and knowing that this blessing is from Allah Azza wa Jal. And you give thanks and you're grateful to the blessing through your limbs by acting and using it in the obedience of Allah Azza wa Jal. So for example, praying. That's praying. So for example, Allah Azza wa Jal gave you strength, gave you youthfulness. So you use that youthfulness and that strength to carry out the servitude of Allah Azza wa Jal. That's limbs. And you protect it from the disobedience of Allah. And then thirdly, through your statements, which is what you said, which is to thank Allah Azza wa Jal and to say Alhamdulillah, to thank Allah Azza wa Jal for this blessing. That's gratefulness. And then we mentioned the second thing that author mentions is that if a person is tested with a calamity, then he is patient. And patience here is obligatory. Being patient when a calamity befalls you is obligatory. And if you seek the reward and you're patient, you do not complain, then Allah Azza wa Jal will give you reward for that. So this is the second thing the life of a Muslim revolves around. If you're given a blessing of Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah Azza wa Jal gives you sam'a wa basar, He gives you sight and hearing. He gives you food, clothes, and a place to stay. All of these are blessings. You have to give shukr for it. You have to be grateful to it. And then secondly, if you're tested with a calamity, a family member dies, or you're involved in a car accident, or you lose a limb, or the likes from the calamities of the world, then you have to be patient. And then thirdly, if you fall into sin, then you seek forgiveness from Allah Azza wa Jal. And this is the signs and the recipe for happiness. And then the Mu'allif rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, اعلم أرشدك الله لطاعته أن الحنيفية ملة إبراهيم. The author, he says, no, meaning have knowledge and do not be ignorant. Have knowledge and do not be ignorant of what he's about to inform you and what he's about to tell you. Do not be heedless of it. Pay attention to it. Because what he's about to tell you is the most important thing in the life of a Muslim. اعلم. Then he says, may Allah have mercy upon you. He makes dua for the student. The author here is making dua for the student and the reader. And this shows the gentleness and the kindness of the author to his students and to the readers, and that he wants khair for them, that he wants good for them. So he says, may Allah guide you to his obedience. أن الحنيفية ملة إبراهيم. Write down. أن الحنيفية. الحنيفية is that a person turns away from shirk and turns towards at-tawheed. And the word al-hanifiyya comes from the root word al-hanaf. And hanaf is something that is crooked and bent, something that's not straight, it's crooked. And that's why if someone's leg is crooked and bent, in the Arabic language they are called ahnaf. If their leg is crooked, they are called ahnaf. And that's where the word comes from. So al-hanifiyya here, which is the religion of Ibrahim, is that a person turns away from shirk towards at-tawheed. And then he explains that this is the religion of Ibrahim, and تَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ مُخْلِصًا لَهُ الدِّينِ, that you worship Allah Azza wa Jal and make the religion sincere for him. And you make the religion sincere for him. And then the Shaykh here, he starts off by mentioning four matters. This is introduction to the book. He hasn't gone into the lubb al-mawdu', the main portion of the book. But here he's about to mention four introductions. So pay attention. The first affair that he wants to teach and to highlight and to make crystal clear is the purpose and the wisdom of our creation. What is the purpose of our creation? The young ones.
To worship Allah.
You guys agree? Anyone disagree? Is it the correct answer? What is the purpose of your creation?
To worship Allah.
Okay, good. So the first thing the author wants to highlight here is that the purpose and the wisdom of our creation is to worship Allah Azza wa Jal alone, singling out worship for Him. And then he mentions the evidence, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, and I did not create the jinn and the mankind except to worship me alone. And here you find that the Shaykh is cultivating, and he does this in more than one book, that he's cultivating the student upon learning the evidences for the masail and the matters that he studies. That he doesn't take something and doesn't ask no questions, or take it and blind follows the sheikh without asking for any proof. If you're taught something, then you have every right to ask, what is your proof? What is your dalil? So here, he's nurturing you upon that methodology of learning your knowledge through evidences from the Quran and the Sunnah. So the Mu'allif here, he says, the purpose and the wisdom of our creation is that we worship him alone. What's the evidence? Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. And I did not create the jinn and the mankind except to worship me. So this is the first matter that the Shaykh wants to talk about. What's the first matter? The purpose of our creation, which is to worship Allah Azza wa Jal alone. You got that? Write it down. Write it down. That the purpose of our creation is to worship Allah Azza wa Jal alone. And he mentions the evidence. Then the Mu'allif, he says, if you have come to know that, if you have come to know that Allah Azza wa Jal, he only created you to worship him, then know, this is the second matter, then know that worship is not considered and is not accepted and is not called worship unless it is coupled and connected with a Tawheed. A Tawheed has to go hand in hand with your worship. Meaning, if you do an act of worship, it has to be for Allah Azza wa Jal alone. That you only make dua to Allah Azza wa Jal alone. That you only seek help and aid and slaughter to Allah Azza wa Jal alone. The affair of ibadah has to be coupled with a Tawheed. And this is the second matter. So the first matter, what's the first matter? To worship Allah alone. What's the second matter? The first matter that the Shaykh here is talking about is a silsila. It's connected. So the first thing that the Shaykh talks about after making dua for the student is he clarifies the purpose and the wisdom behind our creation, which is to worship Allah Azza wa Jalla alone. Easy. Tayyib. That worship that you're created for, it's not correct and it's not considered worship unless it is coupled with Tawheed. And Tawheed is to single out Allah Azza wa Jalla in worship. Right? Tayyib. That's the second thing. And he makes it clear by giving an example. And the example of that is the prayer, the salah. If a person starts praying Salat al-Asr, but he doesn't have wudu, is his salah accepted?
No.
Is his salah considered salah?
No.
He's missing the most important shart. He doesn't have wudu. Is there any benefit in him praying?
No.
Likewise, someone who is doing ibadah, if he doesn't have tawheed, then there's no benefit in that worship. There's no fa'idah from it at all. Understand? Is it clear? Tayyib. Someone is praying salah for, in the night prayer, he prays for 3 hours, but he doesn't have wudu. Is his salah accepted?
No.
Is it called salah?
No.
Even if he does ruku' and sujood, and he does all acts of salah, if he doesn't have wudu, it's not considered salah. Likewise, your ibadah, your worship. If he does all the acts of the worship in the world, he prays, he makes dua to Allah Azza wa Jal in front of the Kaaba, but is not to Allah Azza wa Jal alone, is not coupled with Tawheed, he doesn't sing Allah Azza wa Jal out, there's no benefit in that. So that's the second matter the Shaykh wants to discuss or lay down. So the first is the purpose of our creation. The second is that worship that we are created for is not correct except if it's coupled with Tawheed. And then thirdly, the Shaykh talks about if a shirk, associating partners with Allah Azza wa Jal, it creeps into the worship, it mixes with the worship of a slave. He's doing act of worship, but it's mixed with a shirk, then his acts of worship are null and void. It's corrupt. And a shirk is that you associate partners with Allah Azza wa Jal. And then he makes this example clear again with the prayer, so that you understand it. Here he says, if a person is praying salat, again we say, let's say salat al-maghrib. He's praying salat al-maghrib, and then a baby comes to him and urinates on his clothes. He urinates on his clothes. or the one that's praying passes wind, is his salah still valid? No. He broke his salah, right? He broke his salah. Either he passed wind or a baby came and urinated on him. So it broke his salah. Why? A hadith came upon his salah. Tayyib. Someone who has an act of ibadah. Okay? And this act of ibadah is coupled with tawheed at the beginning. So it's considered ibadah, is correct. And then in the middle of his ibadah, or after the act of ibadah, shirk mixes with it. Shirk mixes with the act of ibadah. Is that ibadah valid anymore? No, right? Is it clear? It's clear. Do you understand the example? If you guys don't understand or anyone has a question, just put your hand up, I can repeat. Okay, these four things are connected. So number one, someone over there. What's the first thing the Shaykh laid down in the book that we talked about? What's the first thing? Now we've talked about three things. Anyone on this side? Huh? Can't hear you. No, after the du'as. To worship Allah Azza wa Jalla alone. The purpose of our creation. Look, it's easy. The purpose of our creation is to worship Allah alone. Tayyib. This worship that Allah Azza wa Jalla created you for, it goes into the second matter. The second matter is that worship is not correct and considered ibadah up until it's coupled with a tawheed. And then thirdly, even if it was coupled with a tawheed and it was considered ibadah, if it mixes in the middle of your act of ibadah with shirk, or at the end with shirk, then that ibadah is considered null and corrupt and zero. It's not accepted. Okay, so that's what the Shaykh talks about in the first three things. And then the Shaykh, he says, نعم. So he says, فَإِذَا عَرَفْتَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ خَلَقَكَ لِعِبَادَتِهِ فَاعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْعِبَادَةَ لَا تُسَمَّى عِبَادَةً إِلَّا مَعَ التَّوْحِيدِ كَمَا أَنَّ الصَّلَاةَ لَا تُسَمَّى صَلَاةً إِلَّا مَعَ الطَّهَارَةِ فَإِذَا دَخَلَ الشِّرْكُ فِي الْعِبَادَةِ فَسَدَتْ كَالْحَدَثِ إِذَا دَخَلَ فِي الطَّهَارَةِ فَإِذَا عَرَفْتَ أَنَّ الشِّرْكَ إِذَا خَالَطَ الْعِبَادَةَ أَفْسَدَهَا وَأَحْبَطَ الْعَمَلَ وَصَارَ صَاحِبَهُ مِنَ الْخَالِدِينَ فِي النَّارِ. So if you've come to know these three things, the purpose of your creation, the importance of coupling ibadah, worship with tawheed, and thirdly, staying away from shirk, that if shirk, knowing that if shirk mixes with your ibadah, that it corrupts it, this is the fourth matter now. فَإِذَا عَرَفْتَ أَنَّ الشِّرْكَ إِذَا خَالَطَ الْعِبَادَةَ أَفْسَدَهَا وَأَحْبَطَ الْعَمَلَ وَصَارَ صَاحِبَهُ مِنَ الْخَالِدِينَ فِي النَّارِ عَرَفْتَ أَنَّ أَهَمَّ مَا عَلَيْكَ مَعْرِفَةُ ذَلِكَ لَعَلَّ اللَّهُ يُخَلِّصَكَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ مِنْ تِلْكَ الشَّبَكَ مِنْ هَذِهِ الشَّبَكَ. So if you've come to know that shirk, if it mixes with your act of worship, that it corrupts it, and the person who falls into it is in the hellfire forever, and that the person who falls into a shirk, Allah Azza wa Jalla will never forgive him, then what is the conclusion that we come to? If this is the results of shirk, a shirk, if you fall into it, all your acts of worship, all of your acts of worship, not that one, all of your acts of worship become corrupt, null, zero, it's not accepted. The person who falls into a shirk, he's in the hellfire forever if he dies upon it. And thirdly, Allah Azza wa Jalla will never forgive him. If that's the results of a shirk, then we come to the conclusion that the most important thing for a Muslim to study and to learn is what? What is the most, if you know these three things, the most important thing for a Muslim to study is what is a shirk and how to stay away from it. Sahwa la la. If you don't know what a shirk is, how do you know you haven't fell into it already? Fahimt? That's why the poet, he says, عرفت الشر لا للشر ولكن لتوقيه من لا يعرف الشر من الخير يقع فيه. I learned and I came to know about evil, not because I want evil, but so I can stay away from it. Whoever doesn't know the evil from the good, he will fall into it. So likewise is the case with a shirk. If you don't know what a shirk is, you don't know its kinds, you don't know the difference between major and minor, you don't know if you are falling into shirk right now, or if you do such and such, you will fall into shirk. How will you know that these results, these things that will happen, that your acts, all your acts of worship will come null, that you might go to the hellfire forever, and that the person that falls into shirk, Allah Azza wa Jalla will not forgive him? How will you not know that if you do not study it? So the Shaykh is basically saying the fourth point, the obligation and the great importance of placing a lot of inayah and importance in studying a shirk and its opposite, a tawheed, so that a person may die upon tawheed and stay away from falling into shirk at all. Clear? Is that crystal clear? Tayyib. And then the Shaykh says, what will help a person in knowing the difference between a shirk and the religion of the mushrikun, the people of shirk, and a tawheed, and the religion of the people of tawheed, is these four principles that he's about to mention. That's what the book is based upon. The four principles. He's going to mention to us four principles that will help us to differentiate between the religion of the mushrikun, the people, the polytheists, and the religion of al-tawheed. And then so he goes into the first principle, which is al-qa'idatul ula. The first principle is that أن تعلم أن الكفار الذين قاتلهم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مقرون بأن الله تعالى هو الخالق الرازق المدبر لجميع الأمور وأن ذلك لم يدخلهم في الإسلام. The first principle is that you have to know that the kuffar, that the disbelievers in the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, that they used to believe that Allah عز وجل is the creator. That they used to believe that Allah Azza wa Jalla is the sustainer, the one that gives life, the one that gives death, and the controller of all affairs. طيب. The kuffar, who are they? Quraysh. The kuffar of Quraysh. He fought them. When did he fight the kuffar of Quraysh? Tell me some of the battles of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. طيب, from the battle of the Prophet ﷺ with the people of Quraysh is the battle of Badr and the battle of Uhud. The battle of Badr and the battle of Uhud. Those kuffar used to believe that Allah Azza wa Jal is the creator, sustainer, the one that gives life, the one that gives death. طيب, why did the Prophet ﷺ fight them there? Why were they considered disbelievers? Why did this not enter them into al-Islam? The clarification to that is that at-tawheed, it goes into three categories. The first is, we'll mention it quickly, Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. And then secondly is Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. And thirdly is Tawheed al-Asma' al-Sifat. The first category, Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, is to single Allah Azza wa Jal out in all the actions that come from Him. The likes of giving life, giving death, sending down rain, helping someone. All of these actions that are from Allah Azza wa Jal coming down to us, they're called Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. The second is Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah is all the actions that we commit, that we make. The actions of the creation to Allah Azza wa Jal. We single Him out. We only pray to Allah Azza wa Jal. We only fast to Allah Azza wa Jal. We only make dua to Allah Azza wa Jal. We only seek aid in Allah Azza wa Jal in times of hardship from Allah. These are our actions going up to Allah alone. That's Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. And Tawheed al-Rububiyyah is the opposite. Those coming down from Allah Azza wa Jal to us, who sends down the rain and the likes. And the third one is the Tawheed of Asma' Sifat, the singling Allah Azza wa Jal out in His names and attributes. Okay, so which of the three, the Kuffar of Quraysh used to believe in one of these three? Which one did they used to believe in? What's the first one? Jazakallah khair. That Allah Azza wa Jal is the creator, sustainer, the one that gives life and death and control affairs. This is all Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. They used to believe that. They never used to fall into shirk in this bab, in this chapter, in this specific category. They used to fall into shirk in the second category, Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. So they would believe Allah is the creator and sustainer and the one that gives life, but they would make dua to other than Allah. That's the second category. They might pray to other than Allah. That's the second category. They might seek aid and help from other than Allah. That's all the second category. The first category, they're muwahidun in that bab. But in the second category, they fell into shirk. That's number one. So we learn from this principle that the kuffar of Quraysh used to believe in Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. That's number one. Write down. That the kuffar of Quraysh used to believe in Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. Secondly, and we'll finish with this, that believing in Tawheed al-Rububiyyah alone is not enough to enter a person into al-Islam. That believing in Tawheed al-Rububiyyah alone, that Allah Azza wa Jalla is the creator, the sustainer, the one that gives life, the one that sends down rain. This is not enough alone to enter a person into Islam. And that is why the Kuffar of Quraysh did not enter into Islam. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ fought them in Battle of Badr and Uhud. And they knew that the meaning of La ilaha illallah, when the Prophet ﷺ used to say to them, قولوا لا إله إلا الله تفلحوا, say لا إله إلا الله, you will become successful. They knew that this meant you have to come with all three types of Tawheed. That you have to come with Rububiyyah, they already believed in. And specifically Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. They knew they were not allowed to make dua to these gods anymore or worship them anymore. And that's why they did not accept al-Islam. Crystal clear? First point, Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. The Kuffar of Quraysh used to believe in Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. Secondly, that believing in Tawheed al-Rububiyyah alone is not enough to enter a person into al-Islam. And we'll stop there and continue after Salah. Nabina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. We'll continue. That's the first principle. The first principle is that, that the Prophet ﷺ, the kuffar that he fought against, that Allah Azza wa Jal commanded him to fight against, the kuffar of Quraysh, in the Battle of Badr and in the Battle of Uhud, that they used to believe that Allah Azza wa Jal, he's the creator, sustainer, the one that gives life, the one that gives death, and the controller of affairs. And we mentioned that that did not enter them into Islam. So they believed in Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. And secondly, believing in Tawheed al-Rububiyyah alone does not enter a person into Islam. And then thirdly, we can likewise say that this is a refutation against those that explain the meaning of La ilaha illallah to be that, that Allah Azza wa Jal is the creator, the sustainer, and the like. They explain La ilaha illallah with Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. And that is an insufficient explanation, and it's erroneous. Because that would mean the Kuffar of Quraysh were Muslims. But they weren't, and they did not say La ilaha illallah because they knew that it entailed the three categories of Tawheed. And from them is Al-Uluhiyyah, which they used to fall into Shirk. Then the Mu'allif again, rahimahullah ta'ala, he's cultivating the student again upon learning this knowledge and the masail of it with its proofs. So he mentions his evidence. He says, وَالدَّلِيلُ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى. And the evidence for that principle, the first one is, قُلْ مَنْ يَرْزُغُكُمْ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَمَّنْ يَمْلِكُ السَّمْعَ وَالْأَبْصَارَ وَمَنْ يُخْرِجُ الْحَيَّ مِنَ الْمَيِّتِ وَيُخْرِجُ الْمَيِّتَ مِنَ الْحَيِّ وَمَنْ يُدَبِّرُ الْأَمْرَ فَسَيَقُولُونَ اللَّهُ فَقُلْ أَفَلَا تَتَّقُونَ. The translation of it being in English. Say, that Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says to them, say, who provides for you from the sky and from the earth, or who owns hearing and sight? And who brings out the living from the dead and brings out the dead from the living? And who disposes of the affairs? They will say Allah. All of these five things that were mentioned are traits of Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. Who's the one that provides for you? Who's the one that controls the sight and the hearing and sends down rain and gives life and gives death? All of these things are Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. So they believed in that. And Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying, say to them, to the Kuffar of Quraysh. What would they say at the end of the ayah? فَسَيَقُولُونَ اللَّهِ. They will say, Allah is the one that provides. Allah is the one that gives life and death. So they used to believe in that. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, أَفَلَا تَتَّقُونَ. أَفَلَا تَتَّقُونَ, meaning, will you not fear Allah Azza wa Jalla's punishment? If this was enough, believing in Allah Azza wa Jalla is the one that provides from the sky and gives life and death was enough to enter a person into Islam, why would Allah Azza wa Jalla say, أَفَلَا تَتَّقُونَ, will you not fear him? Meaning they're not already fearing him, meaning they're not already entered into Islam. So this is evidence for this first principle. So the first principle is, they used to believe in Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, and secondly, it does not enter a person into Islam. And we can also benefit that the erroneous meaning of La ilaha illallah, which is that there's no creator, no sustainer. So the correct meaning of La ilaha illallah is, there's none worthy of being worshipped in truth except Allah. There's none worthy of being worshipped in truth except Allah Azza wa Jalla. Then the Mu'allif rahimahullah ta'ala, he goes to the second principle, which is they're saying, مَا دَعُنَاهُمْ وَتَوَجَّهْنَا إِلَيْهِمْ إِلَّا لِطَلَبِ الْقُرْبَةِ وَالشَّفَاعَةِ. That they will say, we did not call upon them, these things that they worship from the idols and the like, we did not call upon them and turn towards them except to seek nearness to Allah and الشَّفَاعَة, and to seek intercession. قُرْبَة and شَفَاعَة. طيب. So they would set mediators between themselves and Allah Azza wa Jal. They still worship Allah, but they're basically saying our excuse for falling into shirk and tawheed al-uluhiyyah, for calling upon other than Allah, because this is from tawheed al-uluhiyyah, is that we want to seek nearness to Allah. So they set a mediator. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he refutes this doubt and this excuse that they brought. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says about them,
وَالَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ وَالَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَحْكُمُ بَيْنَهُمْ فِي مَا هُمْ فِيهِ يَخْتَلِفُونَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي مَنْ هُوَ كَاذِبٌ كَفَّارٌ.
And the English translation of that is, and those who take awliya, those who take protectors and friends besides him, besides Allah, they say, we worship them only that they may bring us near to Allah. They will only worship them so they can bring us near to Allah. They make them as mediators. Allah Azza wa Jal, he refutes this claim and this excuse that they bring. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, verily Allah will judge between them concerning that wherein they differ. Truly Allah guides not whom he is a liar and a disbeliever. So Allah Azza wa Jal, he wasafahum bi amran, bi amrain. That Allah Azza wa Jal described them with two things. Number one, that they are liars. That they are liars in their claim. And secondly, Allah called them disbelievers. So Allah declared them to be disbelievers. So this excuse is batil, it's false. And to turn to other than Allah, and to call upon other than Allah, with whatever excuse that you have, even if you claim that it's trying to bring closer to Allah, it's still shirk. It's ayn al-shirk. It is the pinnacle point of shirk, because you're calling upon other than Allah. Understand? Clear? Are you everyone with me, Allah? Just talking to myself. May? Tayyib. The first principle is they used to affirm Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. This second one shows and gives an example of how they fell into shirk in Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah by calling upon other than Allah. And the second excuse that they make is shafa'ah. And the evidence for that is the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal. وَيَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَضُرُّهُمْ وَلَا يَنْفَعُهُمْ وَيَقُولُونَ هَٰؤُلَاءِ شُفَعَاؤُنَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. And the English translation is, they worship besides Allah. So they worship, they give an act of ibadah to other than Allah. This is considered shirk. This itself is considered shirk. So they worship besides Allah things that hurt them not, nor profit them. And they say, these are our intercessors with Allah. So they know that this thing that they're worshipping, it doesn't benefit them, it doesn't harm them. Because they acknowledged it. And their excuse for that, even though they know it doesn't benefit them nor harm them, is they are our intercessors. Shufa'a, meaning they will speak to Allah Azza wa Jal for us to remove us from the sins that we are upon, or forgive us, or to send down rain for us, or to give us help when we're in difficulty. We call these mediators, mathalan. There's a righteous person who died many hundred years ago. They will go to his grave, they will build a house above his grave, and they will go to him monthly or weekly, and they will call upon this dead person, and they will say, Ya Ali, or Ya Hussein, or the likes, calling upon other than Allah. And then they will say our excuses, they are closer, they are righteous, they are closer to Allah Azza wa Jal than us. So they will either bring us closer to him, or they will speak to Allah Azza wa Jal for us, so that he may give us provisions, or so that he may provide for us, or so that he may relieve us from the anxiety or the difficult situation we're in. This is shirk itself. And for two reasons. Number one, Allah Azza wa Jal, he does not have any awliya in this regard, meaning people that help him and assist him in the affairs that are specific to him. That's number one. Secondly, Allah gave a direct connection to every single slave to Allah Azza wa Jal directly. So you have a direct relationship with Allah. You have a direct relationship with Allah. Everyone has a direct relationship to Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمُ ادْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. And Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, call upon me and I'll accept you and answer your supplication. Meaning you don't need to go to a mediator and ask him and call upon him. Everyone has a direct connection to Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah Azza wa Jal likewise, he says, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِي إِذَا دَعَانِ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. That if my slaves, Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, if my slaves ask you about me, then tell them indeed I am close. So Allah has a direct relationship with you. You don't need to go to a third party and a mediator to raise your concerns or your worries or your supplications to Allah Azza wa Jal. You have a direct. Let them call upon me and I'll answer their supplication. The supplication of the one who supplicates. So that's the refutation of these two excuses for falling into shirk.
seeking nearness to Allah and so they become shufa'a. And both of them, Allah Azza wa Jal refuted them. Then the Mu'allif mentions that al-shafa'a is shafa'atan, shafa'atun manfiya wa shafa'atun muthbata. The intercession itself is of two types. An intercession that is prohibited and an intercession that is affirmed. An example of intercession that is prohibited is the one that we just mentioned, which is that you go to someone that's dead, even if he was righteous, even if he was a prophet, that you go to him and that you ask him and you call upon him, even though he's dead, he can't hear you, he cannot help you, he can't help himself, that you ask him to go to Allah Azza wa Jal, or to ask Allah to relieve your situation or to help out with your situation. This is batil, this is not allowed. Secondly, an example of an intercession that's affirmed is the example of the Prophet ﷺ making intercession for the people of the Mawqif. The Day of Judgment, when people will be standing for 50,000 years and waiting for the Day of Judgment to begin, the Prophet ﷺ, the people will go to Nuh ﷺ and he will excuse himself. And they will go to Ibrahim and he will excuse himself. They will go to Musa and he will excuse himself. And they will go to Isa alayhi salam and he will excuse himself. And then they will go to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he will go to Allah azza wa jal and prostrate in front of him. And Allah azza wa jal will praise Allah azza wa jal with praises that he does not know of in the dunya. And then Allah azza wa jal will say, irfa' ra'sak, raise your head. Was'al tu'ta, ask and you will be given. Washfa' tushaffa', make an intercession and your intercession will be accepted. This is an accepted and affirmed intercession. Likewise, another intercession that's affirmed is the intercession of the Prophet ﷺ for the people of Tawheed to enter into Jannah, for the first group of people to enter into Jannah, to start. That is likewise an affirmed intercession. And there's other types, that the intercession of the Prophet ﷺ and the righteous people for some people to come out of the hellfire. But as for the batil one, is okay, that's the examples. What's the difference between the one that's affirmed and the one that is prohibited? The qa'ida and the principle that makes it easy is al-shafa'a al-muthbata, is that which is asked from Allah directly. The Prophet ﷺ, he asks Allah to start the Day of Resurrection. The Prophet ﷺ asks Allah directly for the people to enter Jannah. That's al-shafa'a, that's muthbata. Tayyib. Al-shafa'a that's prohibited, that's not affirmed, is a shafa'a that's asked from other than Allah. So you go to the mediator, or you go and ask a dead person, or you ask a righteous person that's not alive. That is all prohibited. And then the Mu'allif says, it goes into explain the two things that we just mentioned. And then he mentions that there's the one that's making intercession and the one that intercession is being made for. The one that's making an intercession, like the Prophet ﷺ, like the Malaika, like the righteous people, some of the people of Jannah will make intercession to Allah Azza wa Jal for other people of Jannah for their ranks to be raised. All of those people that are making intercession, Allah is honoring them. This is a karam and is nobility, is an honor for them to do so. And the one that intercession is being done for, he must be someone that Allah Azza wa Jal is pleased with his qawl and his statements and his actions. And he must have the permission of Allah Azza wa Jal for shafa'a to be done for him. I know I'm doing this quickly, but we're trying to finish the book. So if anything is not clear, if you get the English translation and go over it again when you go home, inshallah it should make more sense. And I'll be posting the audio on my Twitter. I mean, if no one knows it, I can give them my Twitter afterwards and they can listen to the audio afterwards, inshallah. Then the Shaykh goes into the third principle. So the first principle is, we took that Tawheed al-Rububiyyah alone is not enough to enter a person into Islam, and that the Kuffar of Quraysh used to believe in Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. That's why they did not enter into Islam. Second principle is that the Kuffar used to call upon and make dua to other than Allah Azza wa Jal with the excuse of seeking nearness to Allah and intercession. And we explained how that is batil, false, and Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned how they are liars in their claim and declare them to be disbelievers. And then the third principle here is talking about أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ظهر على أناس متفرقين في عباداتهم منهم من يعبد الملائكة ومنهم من يعبد الأنبياء والصالحين ومنهم من يعبد الأشجار والأحجار ومنهم من يعبد الشمس والقمر وقاتلهم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ولم يفرق بينهم. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he encountered people that were different in the things that they worship. So some of them used to worship angels, and some of them used to worship prophets. Some of them would worship righteous men, and others would worship stones and rocks, and the sun and the moon and trees. So the Prophet ﷺ was sent to all these different types of people. Some of them are worshipping the sun, some of them worshipping the moon, some of them worshipping the trees and the stones, some worshipping angels, some worshipping righteous people. All of it, what do they all have in common? All of those things that they're worshipping, what do they have in common? Huh? Shirk. All of it is considered shirk. Even though the thing that they are worshipping are different. Some of them worship righteous people and angels. Some of them worshipping things that don't have life, like rocks and stones. And some of them are worshipping the sun and the moon. But the thing, the common denominator between all of those things, the common factor between them is, they all fall into shirk. And that's why some of the scholars, they use this statement. They say, al-kufru millatun wahida, that disbelief is like one religion. Because as long as you're outside the fold of Islam, it's as if all of those different things that you worship is one thing. It's all shirk, it's all kufr at the end of the day. So that's why the Shaykh is trying to explain here. And the reason why the Shaykh mentioned this here is because a lot of people in his time and the people afterwards, they believe that shirk is only when you worship an idol. That if you was to worship an idol or call an idol or pray to an idol, they believe that that's the only time it would be considered shirk. Here the Shaykh is saying, no, look how the Prophet ﷺ was sent to the Jews who used to fall into disbelief, kufr. They disbelieved the Prophet ﷺ. And then he was sent to Quraysh, who some of them would worship the rocks and stones. Some of them would worship a tamar that they made out of an idol. Some of them would worship the jinn. And the likes, different things that they were worshipping. And even though they were all different in their worship, the Prophet ﷺ was commanded in fighting all of them up until they enter Islam or the likes. Up until they enter Islam or they go into warfare with them. ولم يفرق بينهم. And the main thing here is, he never made a differentiation. لم يفرق بينهم. He didn't differentiate between the one that worshipped an idol and the one that worshipped a righteous person. All of them are the same. So, for example, let's go back to the book. Principle number two: those people that said we worship these righteous people because they bring us near to Allah, and the one that worships the rock that doesn't talk to him is the same, because he's falling to shirk and he's falling into shirk. His shirk is not any less and doesn't make him enter into Islam any better just because he's a righteous person. You understand the intent of the mu'allif? طيب. And then the proof for that is, and we like what this is the third time the Shaykh is mentioning his proof. The proof for that is, وَقَاتِلُوهُمْ حَتَّى لَا تَكُونَ فِتْنَةٌ وَيَكُونَ الدِّينُ كُلُّهُ لِلَّهِ. And fight them until there is no more fitna. And fitna here is disbelief and shirk. And fight them until there is no more fitna, and all of the religion is for Allah alone. And then the Shaykh starts mentioning proof for those things that are being worshipped other than Allah. Proof that some people worship them. So we'll mention them quickly. وَدَلِيلُ الشَّمْسِ وَالْقَمَرِ. That the proof that some people worship the sun and the moon is the statement of Allah عز وجل. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ اللَّيْلُ وَالنَّهَارُ وَالشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرِ. لَا تَشْتُدُوا لِلشَّمْسِ وَلَا لِلْقَمَرِ وَاشْتُدُوا لِلَّهِ الَّذِي خَلَقَهُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ إِيَّهُ تَعْبُدُونَ. That Allah عز وجل, he says, and from amongst his signs are the night and the day and the sun and the moon. Do not prostrate to the sun and the moon, but prostrate to Allah Azza wa Jal if you truly and indeed worship Him. Because some people, you should worship the sun and the moon, and Allah Azza wa Jal is commanding us here not to worship them because it's shirk. ودليل الملائكة, and the evidence that some people worship the angels is the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal, وَلَا يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تَتَّخِذُوا الْمَلَائِكَةَ وَالنَّبِيِّينَ أَرْبَابًا. Nor would He order you, the Most Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, nor would He order you to take angels and the prophets as gods, as idols and things that are worshipped. And the proof that the Anbiya, they are worshipped, that some people worship the prophets, is the Christians, it's clear cut, we live here. The Christians worship some of the prophets, Isa alayhi salam, is from one of the prophets. وَإِذْ قَالَ اللَّهُ يَا عِيسَى ابْنَ مَرْيَمَ أَأَنْتَ قُلْتَ لِلنَّاسِ اتَّخِذُونِي وَأُمِّيَ إِلَٰهَيْنِ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ قَالَ سُبْحَانَكَ مَا يَكُونُ لِي أَنْ أَقُولَ مَا لَيْسَ لِي بِحَقٍّ إِنْ كُنْتُ قُلْتُهُ فَقَدْ عَلِمْتَهُ تَعْلَمُ مَا فِي نَفْسِي وَلَا أَعْلَمُ مَا فِي نَفْسِكَ إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ عَلَّامُ الْغُيُوبِ. Allah عز وجل, He says, O Isa ibn Maryam, Jesus in English, did you say to the men, worship me and my mother as two gods besides Allah? He will say, Subhanak, he will say, glory be to you. It was not for me to say what I had no right to say. Had I said such a thing, you would surely have known it. You know what is in my inner self, though I do not know what is in yours. Truly, you are the all-knower of all that is hidden. And this is a proof that some people worship the prophets. From them is Isa alayhi salam. And the Yahud, the Jews, they worship Uzair. ودليل الملائكة قوله تعالى ولا يأمركم أن تتخذوا we've mentioned already ودليل الصالحين the evidence that some people worship the righteous people is the statement of Allah عز وجل أولئك الذين يدعون يبتغون إلى ربهم الوسيلة أيهم أقرب ويرجون رحمته ويخافون عذابه إن عذاب ربك كان محظورا those whom they call upon those things those righteous people that they call upon they themselves desire good for themselves They desire for themselves means of access to their Lord as to which of them should be nearest and they hope for His mercy and His torment. Meaning, some people they worship the righteous and those righteous people themselves, they used to strive hard in worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal alone and they would fear Him and they would hope, they would have hope in Him and they would love Him. They would carry out those three pillars of ibadah and they would work hard in their worship and servitude of Allah. So how can you worship someone that's striving to worship Allah alone. He's trying to make Tawheed and you're trying to fall into Shirk by worshipping the thing, the person that's trying to do tahqiq of Tawheed, actualize Tawheed. طيب. ودليل الأشجار والأحجار قوله تعالى أفرأيتم اللات والعزى ومناة الثالثة الأخرى And the proof that some people worship stones and trees is the statement of Allah عز وجل Have you considered اللات and العزى and منات and the other third. Meaning the names of these three things Al-Uzza and Al-Lat and Manat, they are names of idols and trees. They are names of things that cannot even speak, Jamad. Some people used to worship them in Hijaz, in the region of Mecca, between Mecca, Medina and Taif. These idols existed and trees. And Allah and the Prophet ﷺ, when he gained quwwah, when he gained strength and he came back to Mecca, he destroyed these idols and trees. People used to worship them. And then the last hadith is a hadith of Abi Waqid al-Laythi. The author rounds up this principle with the hadith of Abu Waqid al-Laythi, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, a companion of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who says, خَرَجْنَا مَعَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِلَى حُنَيْنٍ وَنَحْنُ حُدَثَاءُ عَهْدٍ بِكُفْرٍ وَلِلْمُشْرِكِينَ السِّدْرَةُ الْحَدِيثِ That he said, we departed with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Hunayn. Hunayn is an area outside of Mecca. And they went there for a battle with the Prophet ﷺ. وَنَحْنُ حُدَثَاءُ عَهْدٍ بِكُفْرٍ And we had recently left Kufr. Meaning the Sahabi and some of the Sahaba that were with the Prophet ﷺ, they were from those that entered Islam in Mecca, the conquest of Mecca. They had entered Islam recently. So they just left Kufr recently. They're still studying their religion. They never fully studied completely. Then the Mushrikun, that the Prophet ﷺ going to fight, they used to have a tree which they used to devote themselves to and hang their weapons upon. They used to hang their weapons, the kuffar used to hang their weapons upon this tree, hoping for the blessings of the tree to go on the sword, that it will make the sword stronger, it will make it more firm, that it will not break, and the likes. And this is shirk, seeking the blessings from of a tree. So they used to call it dhatu anwad. So we passed by a tree and said, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, appoint for us, make for us a dhat anwad, just like they have a dhat anwad. So the new Muslims, the ones that just entered Islam, they asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, make for us a tree, just like they have a tree, that we can put our, alayhi wa sallam, that we can put our swords and the likes on. And the Sahabi is making an excuse for himself at the beginning. Why did he say, we recently left Kufr? Because if they had been Sahaba and companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for a long time, they would never have had such a statement. So he's making an excuse for them. That they just left recently. So Allah, the Prophet ﷺ, when he heard this from them, he said, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. By the one whose hand is in my soul, he's swearing by Allah. These are the ways. The like of what you have said is what Bani Israel said to Musa. The example of what you have said, O Sahaba, the new ones that just entered Islam, is the example of what Bani Israel said to Musa alayhi salam. They said to him, make for us a god just as they have gods. They saw people that had gods that they were worshipping. So they asked Musa to make gods for him just like they have gods, which is shirk. And then Musa alayhi salam said, verily you are an ignorant people. And the point here is, the Sahaba, they never fell into shirk. They asked. And the Prophet ﷺ, even though they had an excuse that they just left Islam, they just left Kufr recently and entered Islam recently, the Prophet ﷺ still taught them that this is incorrect. And he said, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, zajran, rejecting this statement that they said. And this is a proof that even a person, if he's new to Islam, that you still have to correct him if you see something that's wrong. But they did not fall into kufr, and they did not fall into shirk. طيب, that's the third principle. The third principle, a quick recap, is that the Prophet ﷺ was sent to different groups of people that worship different things. And even though they worship different things, Allah Azza wa Jal did not differentiate between those things that they worship. And he didn't say if you worship an idol, it's shirk. And if you worship the righteous and angels, it's not shirk. No. All of them are shirk. All of them were declared as shirk. There's no difference. And that's why some of the scholars say, Al-Kufru Millatun Wahida, that disbelief is like one religion. Tayyib. And then the last principle that the Shaykh mentions, the fourth and the last principle, أَنَّ مُشْرِكِي زَمَانِنَا أَغْلَبُ شِرْكًا مِنَ الْأَوَّلِينَ لِأَنَّ الْأَوَّلِينَ يُشْرِكُونَ فِي الرَّخَاءِ وَيُخْلِصُونَ فِي الشِّدَّةِ وَمُشْرِكُ زَمَانِنَا شِرْكُهُمْ دَائِمًا فِي الرَّخَاءِ وَالشِّدَّةِ وَالدَّلِيلُ قَوْلُ تَعَالَى وَمَا شَنَا سَكَرَ. طيب, the fourth point, the fourth principle is that the mushrikun, the polytheists of our time, meaning the author's time, and we can say our time likewise, are worse in their shirk than those that came before, of the mushrikun of old. They are worse than the mushrikun at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. And he explains why. He says that is because those who came before committed shirk during the times of ease. And in the times of difficulty, they would be sincere in their worship to Allah Azza wa Jal. That they would be mukhlis, they would be sincere in their worship to Allah Azza wa Jal. And they are mushrikun. And then we mentioned the Shaykh always brings his proof when he's teaching you knowledge. Here again, he mentions his proof. وَالدَّلِيلُ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى فَإِذَا رَكِبُوا فِي الْفُلْكِ دَعَوُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ فَلَمَّا نَجَّاهُمْ إِلَى الْبَرِّ إِذَا هُمْ يُشْرِكُونَ. And the translation in English is the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal, and when they embark on a ship, when they go up on a ship, they invoke Allah Azza wa Jal, making their faith pure for Him alone. But when He brings them to safety to land, lo and behold, they give a share of their worship to others. Meaning, when they go, they embark upon the ship and the great waves hit them and they think they're about to die and they think that there's no going back. They don't turn to their idols and to the angels and to the righteous people they used to worship on land. Now they're on sea. They know that no one else can save them except for Allah Azza wa Jalla. And remember, we said these people of old, they used to believe in Allah. They used to believe in His rububiyyah, that He's the creator, sustainer. But they used to make shirk with Him. But in this instance, in a time of difficulty specifically, they would be mukhlis, they would be sincere in worship. So they would call upon Allah Azza wa Jal alone. And Allah Azza wa Jal, if a person calls, even if a kafir, calls upon him and he's oppressed, then Allah Azza wa Jal will answer his call. So here, they were in difficulty and Allah Azza wa Jal would save them from that difficulty. And then when they come back to land and safety and there's no more fear, then they would go back to worshipping other than Allah. They would fall into shirk. So they would fall into shirk in one of the two instances. You're either between ease or hardship. When it's hardship, they would be sincere to Allah Azza wa Jal. When they're in ease and there's no problems, they would fall into shirk billah Azza wa Jal. Tayyib. So why are they worse than the mushrikun of our time and the time of the author? That is because those in our time and in the time of the author, when it's in time of ease, they fall into shirk. And when it's in times of difficulty, do they turn to Allah? No, they're still up on shirk. Da'iman, between difficulty and easy, they're always in shirk. Instead of saying, Ya Allah, they will say, Ya Ali, Ya Badr, in times of hardship. And this is shirk billah, because you're calling upon other than Allah. And giving any act of worship to other than Allah Azza wa Jal is shirk. So their shirk is da'im, is always. And that is why they fall into, that's why they're worse than the mushrikun in the time of the Prophet. And the reason why the mu'allif is saying this is because some people, they think that just because you say La ilaha illallah, that if you come with any nullifier, all the nullifiers that take a person out of Islam, but as long as it's just La ilaha illallah, they think that it won't take them outside the fold of Islam. So here he's proving that, look, those in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, they fell into shirk in one instance and they were considered mushrikun. Those that are in our time are falling into shirk at all times. They are more deserving of being declared kuffar. And that is the end of the book. وَتَمَّتْ وَصَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى أَهْلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمَ. But two important points that I want to mention. The Shaykh mentions in principle number three that Allah Azza wa Jal commanded the Prophet ﷺ to fight them all. this issue of jihad is an affair that's established in our religion. Na'am. Jihad is part of our religion. Na'am. To fight the kuffar is part of our religion. Na'am. But, and a big but, there are rules and regulations. There are things that have to be considered before a person falls goes into that bab. Okay? So from them is that it has to be from a Muslim ruler. From them is that if a person is, he's got parents, he has to ask his parents for permission. A man came to the Prophet ﷺ all the way from Yemen, and he says, I want to do jihad with you, O Messenger of Allah. And then he says, are your parents alive? He said, no. He goes, have you sought permission? He said, no. He goes, go back to your parents. Ask them for permission. So this is something that you have to look at before. There are other things and rules that have to be looked at. And they're mentioned in the books of fiqh. Okay. That's number one. Number two, if a person, this is still the same point, if a Muslim country signs a peace treaty and a truce with a non-Muslim country, then it's not allowed for any Muslim to break that peace treaty. Meaning, you're not allowed to kill any of the non-believers in that, if there's peace treaty. You're not allowed to do dhulm of them, oppress them. You're not allowed to cheat them. You're not allowed to do any of those things. So the example is, what's the evidence? We always mention, bring your evidence. Okay, what's my evidence? The evidence is, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived in Medina. Okay? And he made a peace treaty with the Kufar of Quraysh, those people he was commanded to fight. After the Battle of Badr and Uhud, later on, they made a peace treaty. It's called Sulh al-Hudaybiyah. طيب. The Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, there were things in there that were mentioned that might sound like a disadvantage to the Muslimun. Okay? And might sound like the Muslimun are being ripped off. But there might be a short-term or a medium-term or a long-term benefit. So if the imam and the ruler sees that, then he's allowed to sign a peace treaty and a contract with them, and all those underneath the ruler have to listen and obey. Okay? So the Prophet ﷺ signed, and one of the things that were in that contract is, if someone becomes a Muslim from Mecca, from the Kufar, and he comes to Medina, they have to send him back. And if someone becomes a non-Muslim from the Muslims in Medina and wants to go to Mecca, then he's allowed to go. There's a disadvantage, right? For Zahir, in the apparent. But there was a benefit in that contract. To the point that even when they were writing it, it said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, it said, by Muhammad ibn Abdullah, the Messenger of Allah. Or Muhammad ibn Rasulullah. Muhammad is the Messenger of Allah. They said, we don't recognize you to be the Messenger of Allah. Rub it off. Ali radiallahu anhu, who is the companion and the nephew of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, found it too great for him to wipe away the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's name. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wiped it off himself, even though he's illiterate. He asked, where is it? And he rubbed it off himself. This all seems like disadvantages. But what were the benefits? From the benefits is, this opened the door of dialogue and conversation with the Kufar of Quraysh. Before this, majority of the time was war. But now, there was a peace treaty, they were able to go to Mecca and call them to Islam. Okay, that's number one. Number two, they could focus on other areas that they needed to focus on. And to summarize, the benefit, you can look at it in numbers. Those that came to Sulh Hudaybiyah from the Muslims were 1,400 with the Prophet ﷺ. A couple of years later in Fath Mecca, there were 10,000. In 2 or 3 years. The reason why they came back to do the conquest of Mecca is because the Kufar broke the peace treaty. When they broke the peace treaty, the Prophet ﷺ came and took over Mecca, and there were 10,000 in number. Look how they went. 10 times the number that they were just a couple of years ago. Okay? And look at even further. When he went to the Hajj, the Hajj of the Prophet ﷺ, the ninth year, there was 100,000 Muslim Sahaba. 100,000. Just a couple of years before, they were only 1,400. Those that did bay'ah tahta Shajarat Radwan, they were only 1,400 when they were making that peace treaty. A couple of years later, they became 100,000. Look how many people entered into Islam. That's from the benefits of the contract. So Sheikh bin Baz, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, if any Muslim ruler today was to sign a peace contract with a non-Muslim country, then it's not allowed for anyone to say anything about it. Because there might be a short-term, medium-term, long-term benefit. Okay, so how does that concern us? We're living in UK right now. This affair of now fighting Kala, it's not for us. We're not in a Muslim country. We're not in an army of a Muslim country. And we're living in a non-Muslim land. We have to obey and listen to the rules.
as long as it does not go against our Sharia. We're not allowed to kill their people. We're not allowed to oppress them. We're not allowed to steal from them. Like the Khawarij say, this is the methodology of the Khawarij. The Prophet ﷺ warned against the Khawarij sternly. So this is the first point. Everyone understand that? It's clear?
Yes.
Clear, inshallah. That's the first point. When the author talks about fighting, you have to look at it with those in that context. That's number one. And secondly, I'll say one more thing about this, because it's so important. When you go into the books of fiqh, when you're studying the books of fiqh, first you study, it's talking about ahkam, the rulings that you have to know. The first thing you study is purification. The second thing you study is salah. The third thing you study is zakah. Then siyam, then hajj, then buyur. Where is jihad? Jihad is near the end of the book. People want to enter, people start practicing, and the first thing they want to do is jihad and learn about jihad. And it's at the end, but they don't know any of this. Doesn't make any sense. So pay attention to that. Don't fall to the tricks and doubts of those people. That's number one. Secondly, the author talks about the fourth principle we mentioned. They are more deserving of being declared kuffar. This issue of taking someone outside the fold of Islam is an issue that is for the scholars alone. It's not for us. We don't say, look, you did this, you did this, you're a kafir. No. It's not for us to do. That's for the scholars. If you see someone, what you do is you protect yourself from shirk. If you see a friend or a family member or someone committing shirk, calling upon other than Allah, you give da'wah to him, you say, Akhi, this is shirk, Allah is a believer, kada, kada, kada. If he accepts, alhamdulillah. If he doesn't accept, it's not for you to declare him a kafir. You've done your job. Keep it moving. That's number one. Secondly, alongside that, there's three things. Takfir, declaring someone outside the fold of Islam. Tafsiq, declaring someone to be an open sinner or yani oppressive sinner, fajr or fasiq. And thirdly, tabdi', taking someone outside the fold of sunnah into bid'ah and declaring to be an innovator. All of these three things are for the scholars only. It's not for us. If we have an issue or concerning that we want to ask about, we raise it to the major scholars and they give a fatwa on it. As for us, yakfina that we study this, we protect ourselves from it, we protect our family members and friends, and if we see someone doing it, we give them da'wah with gentleness and kindness. If they accept it, alhamdulillah. If they don't, then you've done your part. And that's what I wanted to say. Ask Allah to benefit us from this book, and we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to increase us in knowledge and to allow us to actualize Tawheed and to stay away from shirk. This book is Qawaid al-Arba, and it's good that a person reads this more than once. And he finds the English translation and he goes over it again and again so he understands it. And if you can read it to his family members and sisters and brothers and the likes, it would be good. And a good book to study after this would be Thalathat al-Usul, if you're able to. Lessons are online. I'm currently teaching this online in Bristol, every Wednesday and Thursday. We've got Aqeedah series. We finished Qawaid al-Arba'a. We just started Thalathat al-Usul last week. So if a person wants to listen online every Wednesday and Thursday, they can do so. And after we finish Thalathat al-Usul, we're going to go to Kitab al-Tawheed, a whole book on Tawheed, 67 chapters. So if you want to carry on the series on studying an Aqeedah, then you can tune in, bi'idhnillah ta'ala. Hadha wallahu a'lam wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.